بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. كل سنة وانتم طيبين. So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Amr Muhammad. I'm an associate professor in the department since 2007. And I received my PhD in 2006 from University of British Columbia in Canada. So I've been teaching this course for quite some time. And this year they decided to give me all the sections. So at the beginning, we're going to go through the syllabus. And for me, the syllabus is just the contract between the instructor and the students. So we need to seal that contract by the end of this lecture, and we need to agree on all the terms and conditions in that syllabus. So basically, this is the introduction for myself, and that's the phone number for my office and the email. So the office hour for the boys is gonna be on Sundays, because I have Sundays and Tuesdays for both boys and girls. And because I have to move all the way there, the Tuesday is booked already by the girls. So unfortunately, you don't have a choice. Although I can, based on the request of the students, I can try to move it somewhere where it's suitable for everyone. However, I will give you some alternatives in case this office hours is not suitable. And basically for the boys it's going to be easy, because you can simply drop by my office and we can chat. But for the girls, they are, well, now as per the college policy, they are discouraged to come to the male campus and things like that. So I try to give them some alternatives. So you guys are safe. So at least some advantage for on your side.
Not really. This is balancing.
Balancing, yes. Okay. So the course, as you all know, is Introduction to Networks. So this is the course description. So the objective, the main goal of this course, is just to give you some introduction about computer networks, how they work. We're gonna go through the network stack and the different layers and stuff. We're gonna try to understand how many of the technologies that we have nowadays, how they work, and how they come about, and how they work efficiently, and so on and so forth. We're gonna go through some protocols and techniques that facilitates the communication between computers, between human beings, and so on. So that's basically what the course is all about. The material is very important. So basically, the main source of the material is the online Cisco material. And we're gonna go through CCNA1 version 5.1. And that has some implication, because in previous years we did not teach 5.1, we used to teach 4.0, so there is a significant difference. And there are many changes this year that I will have to go through. Okay. These are some of the references that you are welcome to use. If you have some of these books, you can actually use, in case you don't get any concepts or techniques that we go through in class. You are welcome to refer to these books. They are relevant to the course, and you can get more details about what we discuss in class. However, if you follow exactly what I say, I don't think you will need anything other than the online Cisco material. Okay. So objectives of the course, it's basically, as I said, introduction to various concepts in computer networks. You will learn some common protocols and standards like IPv4, IPv6, UDP, TCP. You will get to learn how these protocols actually work and how they facilitate the communication between the different entities. Also, we will learn some concepts related to lower layers, so we'll get some idea about signals and how data is converted into signals and things like that. Very rough idea about this part. Of course, you will get more details for computer engineering people who get Network 2. They will get more information about this part. We'll study routing and subnetting, which is roughly the most important part of the course, and it's the biggest part of the course. And sorry, and this is basically like some ABIT stuff. So it's just to put the objectives, map it to program outcomes and stuff like that. But it's not very important. Yeah. So these are the weeks and the topics that we'll cover every week. So this week we're gonna cover the first chapter, which is just a motivational chapter. It does not have like a very condensed material. But it's just to give you some motivation why the topic is important. And then in next week, we're going to go through chapter 3, because chapter 2 is going to be covered fully in the lab. It's just a configuration of network devices and stuff. So we're not going to go through that in class. But in class next week, we're going to talk about chapter 3. Okay? You can follow the weeks here. Of course, the lectures will not have to match this 100%, so we're going to have to move things back and forth depending on the interaction and depending on how things go. That's the most important part. So you'll find that the assessment criteria this year is totally different, because the new material has triggered us to, and by us I mean myself, to make some changes to the way that we assess and the way that we actually teach the course. So assignments are the same. So we're going to have two assignments, homeworks, and these are 15%. That we're going to have two midterms, not one like we used to do. So we're going to have two midterms, and the weight for the midterms is pretty high, it's 40. Quizzes, okay, so we're going to have 10 quizzes, which is a lot. I know it's a lot, but I will give you the reason why I did this year. And just to give you some idea, the quizzes here is very, very short. It's like 5-minute quiz, and I will give you the reason why I did this this year. Final, of course, I'm forced to put it maximum 30% as per the university policy. Okay, so that's it regarding the syllabus. Any questions or anything? So the assessment is the most important part of this. And if you have,
there are no projects, right?
The project is going to be in the lab. Yes. So you're going to have to work in groups, but as part of the lab.
This course syllabus will be a part of the CCNA certification?
Yes, that's a good question. At the end of this course, that's one thing that we couldn't do in the last couple of years. That's what triggered us to actually change the material to 5.1. Because in the last couple of years, even though Cisco had actually released 5.1, but because of the approvals that we have to go through in the curriculum committee, we couldn't teach this material in the last couple of years. In which case, the students did not have the luxury to go through the online Cisco exam at the end and get the certificate. So we had so many complaints from students last year, and that's actually moved these complaints to the curriculum committee, and that's actually motivated them to sit down and discuss things, and then finally they approved the new material, and that's what we're doing this year. Okay? So at the end of this course, we will give you the chance, for those of you who are interested, you feel free, and it's not part of the assessment of the course. The assessment of the course is totally separate. Okay? But at the end, you will have the option to do one online exam and get the certificate. And this, you can do it otherwise in Cisco Academy, but you have to pay like 2,500 real to get the certificate for CCNA1. So this is actually an advantage for our students that we give this to you for free if you want. Okay? This is just declaration of. Okay, so now we get to important stuff. So as I said, the new material has triggered us to teach the course in a different way. So I'm not sure how many of you is familiar with flipped classes or tried it before or heard about it. Okay, so it's not an invention. I'm not the one who invented flipped classes, but flipped classes they work as follows. So first, I'm gonna have to record all the lectures of the course in video recording offline, in addition to what we're doing now, offline, with the only exception of the first week, because we have, you didn't know, so I have to go through it this way and have to record it this way. But starting from next week, actually this week you have the clips or the video for next week that we will cover next week. Okay? And you have to watch these videos over the weekend or at your free time. Okay? And I will do my best to make this these videos like maximum 3 clips, and the total of this is not more than like 1 hour by any chance. And actually, for those of you who know the trick on YouTube, that you can speed up like by 25%, and this way it becomes like 45 minutes. So this way you can save some time. But you need to go through this video before the lecture next week. Okay? You need to watch it before the lecture next week. In which case, I expect you to be a little bit familiar with the material before you come in class on Sunday. Okay? To make sure that this will happen, of course, because if we have it as an option, usually things are not done, but to make sure that this will happen, that's why we have these frequent quizzes. So almost every week, you will have a quick quiz. It's just like 3-4 small questions, just multiple choice, true and false, things like that. Very simple. Just to make sure that you have gone through the video. Okay? And of course, you don't have to get 100% of all these quizzes. So we will remove some of the, I will get مثلاً the best 10 out of 12 or 8 out of 10, something like that. So you can slack here or there like a couple of times, no problem. But on the average, I expect you to watch the videos every week, just 1 hour before the lecture. The other technique to kind of enforce this a little bit is that during the lecture, we will have more in-depth discussions. So we will not go through the material one by one, but we will have some activities, okay, that will allow us to have constant interaction, so you're going to have to work in pairs, at least in pairs, okay, and go through things. And then we will have interaction, and then I will come here and I will explain some of the concepts on this. And if I explain things and I find it hard, I will record it. I will make sure it's recorded and it's also posted on YouTube. So at the beginning of the lecture, usually I will just briefly summarize the material, and then I will give you some activity that you will go through. I'm gonna have to go around and make sure that that you're doing, that you're progressing in the activity and so on. So this has many benefits, and as I said, I'm not the inventor of the flip classes. Many people have tried this before, even at QU. And if you embrace this, I think you will find it useful, that it facilitates this constant interaction, and it allows us to go deeply in the material, and it also allows me to make sure that you absorb the material, because in the past, we used to do it the traditional way of one-way communication. So I just dump the material on your brains, and that's it. So there's no way for me to make sure that you really absorb the material. So this way, we're gonna have some interaction that allows me to really make sure that most of you at least have got the idea of what we're talking about. So the sequence is, you watch the videos, we come only on Sundays, we will have it, but not every lecture, of course, only on Sundays. And if we delay things, it's gonna be, but we have to agree, make it on Tuesday. But we'll make it on Sunday. And that's another thing that will force people to come on time, at least on Sunday, to make sure that you go through the quiz. The 10 quizzes are gonna have a weight of 15%. So as I said, you can slack a little bit here or there, but make sure that you get the most of it, okay? And then in the class, we're gonna have to go through some class activities. explaining important concepts, go through some exercises.
The quizzes, the material of the quizzes will be covered only in the videos, right? Or to include the things we take in the lecture?
The online material includes everything.
No, I mean the quiz.
The quiz is going to be related to the video.
Just the video.
Just the video. So you need to watch the video. Okay? So I will pick just some keywords in the video just to make sure that you have gone through the video. That's it. Okay? It's going to be online. We're going to do the quiz. I will try to do it online on Blackboard. So you can do it using your cell phone, your laptop, anything. But of course, I know that when this happens, things go out of control a little bit. And things move here and there, and I will try to move around this and make sure that that nothing weird is going to happen. And I hope nothing is going to happen. The documentation, as I said, the best reference is the online material. Of course, there are some references and some on the internet that we may have to refer to. Of course, one important thing is that I don't expect you to know something that I don't cover in class. So that's very important. So even if something in the material that I skipped in the video, I skipped it on purpose. And I don't want you to know the details of this, okay? For a reason. And the other way around, if we cover things in class, even if they are not in the online material, then I expect you to know it. And at the end, the tests are gonna be from the things that we discuss in class and the video. It's not something outside of these two. Okay, clear? I highly encourage the participation, and I know in mail it's a little bit easier, so I hope it is actually more evident in this class that we're going to have participation. Not like things go out of control, but we need to do it in a positive way so that we have enough interaction and we make sure that we discuss concepts efficiently. This is the instruction on how to download the material. This is posted on the course website. Maybe some of you have already looked at it. I've made the course available yesterday. So this is the instruction. The material is not on the Cisco website just yet. I sent it last week to Shmans Muhammad, but he did not post it on the Cisco website yet. So by the end of this week, the material should be there. But for now, you can watch the video, and the video is actually from the online material. I was debating with myself whether to do the recording based on offline presentations that I develop or the online material. After huge debate with myself, actually, I realized that the online material contains some animations and videos that you cannot replicate in the presentation, really. It's very hard. Therefore, after I prepared all the presentations, I decided to do it directly on the online material, which makes it, I think, a little bit easier because this is your main source. So if you watch the videos, if you know the activities that we discuss in class, that's what you need to look at, nothing else. With the only exception of this week, because this week, of course, there's no video beforehand, so we will have to do things in the traditional way. So I posted only the presentation for this week on Blackboard. But starting from next week, everything is going to be from the online material. I also tried in previous years to upload the material itself on Blackboard, not just the link. But that failed because the material tends to be very large. Only last night, some idea came to me that maybe I can try this year and see if things are different, because the material for 5.1 is different. Maybe they made it some in an optimized way, and maybe now I can upload it to Blackboard. So I will do that. I didn't have the chance to do it this morning, but I will try to do it. If so, you will have the link for the material directly on Blackboard rather than just going through this.
The size of the file itself is big?
It's big, yes.
Okay,
it's pretty big.
There's a program called 7-Zip. You can put the will cut it down to such size. And then we can just download part one, part two, part three, and then put them together, press on one of them, and go.
Well, if that's the case, then I prefer to do it from the Cisco website. I mean, the instruction is not that difficult. Yeah, I mean, if we have to download, because if you go through the Cisco website, it's just one link and you can download it easily. If things are that complicated, then I'd rather to go through this instruction. You just need to know basically this password. You put it on the on your browser and that's it. So it's not that difficult. Okay. One thing to remember is that you have to use Firefox to see the material. The other browsers do not work. Okay, I tried it myself.
It is just the bucket tracer.
No, it's not related to packet tracer. Even the online material itself, the HTMLs and stuff, you will see that some of the videos they will not appear appropriately if you don't use Firefox. I tried all the three browsers. Okay. Office hours, we discussed this. Some alternatives, I actually created a general discussion board on Blackboard. Okay, so feel free to send your questions by email or post your questions on the general discussion board. I encourage you to use all these different means for communicating your questions. And I know that, again, I mean, for mail, it's a little bit easier because you can send me an email and I can come to your office at this point in time. I give you my free time and you can drop by, so there's no problem. Okay, so any question? I will do quickly now, very quickly, and then more details we can talk about in class. As I said, it's a little bit separate from the assessment in the course. The Cisco material, the Cisco certificate, there is the Cisco Regional Academy. You can go through the four different modules of CCNA. In the course, we go through only one module, the CCNA 1. Okay. You get the certificate after completing each module. There is an online exam and there is a lab test. Luckily for this course, the lab exam is going to be part of the Cisco grade directly. So all you need to do is just to do the online exam at the end. So online exam and the lab test. The test that you will do in the lab is going to be part of the Cisco. Okay. But anything that you do it like the online exam is not part of the assessment of the course. Okay, so that's what you need to know. About how beneficial, I mean, it's international certification that's very well known worldwide, and people have been using this to get employed quickly and things like that. So it does make a difference when it comes to employability. So it does make a difference. Of course, people expect you to know the four modules, but at least as part of this course, you go one step. So you finish one step out of the four modules. Any other questions? So we'll quickly go through the very few slides of the first chapter. And as I said, this whole chapter is just motivation. It's not, you know, it does not contain like very detailed information, but this is just scratching the surface of what networks mean and how the emerging trends and technologies like cloud computing, like data centers and Facebook and things like that, how they use the network to make these technologies valid. So we're going to go through four different sections. First, how the network can make people and computers globally connected. We're going to talk about LANs and WANs, and we will talk about what they mean exactly. The network as a platform. So we're going to talk about how the network is composed or is divided into devices, network devices, end devices, and so on. We're going to talk about how the the network changes the way we design our environment or our daily life. So at the beginning, this graph here shows the trend for the evolution of the number of devices that are connected globally on the internet. This graph is very famous. It's done by Cisco, and many people they refer to this graph. The idea is that by year 2020, we're expected to reach like 50 billion, and we cannot say devices in that case, because everything on Earth is going to be connected to the internet. Your shirt, your pen, your table, your fridge at home, it's going to be connected to the internet. It's going to have a chip, an IP address somehow, and it's going to be connected to the internet. So all our things will be communicating together. It's not devices anymore. It's not human beings. It's not cell phones anymore. It's just everything. Your chair is going to be part of the internet. So that's why we call them things. And there is, as we maybe you might have heard this term, Internet of Things. So we're expected to have around 50 billion things that are connected on the internet by year 2020. So we can see that every like few years, every like 5 to 10 years, the number of devices on the internet, it almost doubles. So it's not like an increase exponential or something. It's just the number of things or devices, they double. Okay, so you can imagine the amount of sophistication and scalability and issues that have to be in place in the network in order to support this large number of devices. So with that, we're going to be globally connected. So we're going to have, this is the how the telepresence, if some of you have heard about telepresence from Cisco, it's just a technology that allows people to have meetings like this. And as we can see, these people are actually, they are mobile, they are on a different continent, and they are sitting in the round table as if they are in the local room. So these people can even shake their hands, and they can interact with them as if they are on the same round table. So we are globally connected, but locally interacting. So that's what the network can give us. Of course, to make an application like this efficient, you need so many protocols and techniques and things like that make this happen. So that's an example, but networks have actually changed or supported the way we learn. So we have Blackboard, we have so many things. We can now, we can have like a remote class. We can have an instructor thousands of miles away, and we can interact with them, and we can watch them while they are teaching the class and so on. And you can have a class that's as efficient as we are doing now, but the instructor might be remote. And as you might have heard, many people have tried this already, like the remote learning. Support the way we communicate through cell phones, through landlines, and so on. Support the way we work. Even in our work, we use networks in a way. So support the way that we even play. And maybe some of you will try games and stuff, and now the trend is that people, they play games together using the network. So in order for us to provide this large networks or this scalability to support communication between people, whether in a very small area or in a very remote area, we have the approach of hierarchical design of the network. So you have a network that supports a small home. So at home, we have a small network that supports few devices and they are connected together. So maybe in that case, we use wireless for luxury, but we can actually connect this using cables, very short cable, and it's reasonable in size. However, if you go in a large area, like an office, large office, in that case, connecting these devices by cables might be prohibitive, in which case you have to use different types of network devices or technologies and things like that. If you go in a building and different floors and stuff, then the design is going to be totally different. If you go through a worldwide networks, like the ultimate network is the internet, then you need to have many service providers in place, like Ooredoo and Verizon and AT&T and all these service providers that give you broadband communication to be able to communicate with people on other countries or continents. So the design of the network depends heavily on the size of this network. Okay, and the types of network devices that you use depends heavily on how your network is actually distributed. From the application point of view, like for us as users, we don't care about network devices. I don't deal with switches or routers, and I don't need to know about them. But I need to know about applications. So from the application point of view, the network or the internet is divided into clients and servers. Okay, clients are just the entities that initiate the communication, or they request something from the server. The server is just a listener, and it has some services and content which can be absorbed or consumed by the client. Okay, so the client is the entity that always initiates the communication. The server never starts communication with someone. Always the client requests the communication from the server, and then the server responds accordingly. Okay, an example of this is that you have the simplest example is just your browser. So when you say google.com, what happens is that your browser, as a client, it requests the server, the web server on the Google side, to get the content of google.com web page and bring it to your client. So that's the simplest example. Another example is of course our mail email server in ITS. So again, there is a server in ITS that you request your emails to be fetched, and then you go through your emails one by one. You can download a file from FTP server, so in which case you have to use an FTP client. So the network is divided into clients and server, and that's the definition of each one of them. So the client is the one that initiates the communication, and the server responds accordingly. Is that the only architecture in networks? The answer is no. So recently, in the last like two decades, another paradigm came about on the internet, which is what we call peer-to-peer. And the best example of this is BitTorrent. So my machine, once you put BitTorrent, your machine works as a client and a server at the same time. So there's no distinction that this application is a client and this application is a server. There's no that distinction anymore. Any peer-to-peer application makes your machine to work as a client and as a server at the same time. Okay? So what is the benefit of this? Well, there is a huge benefit. Because the client-server architecture has a clear drawback, because it makes the server a bottleneck. So that server, it's supposed to be heavy duty because it serves millions and millions of clients. Okay? So this server becomes like the center, and many clients connect to it. This makes it a bottleneck, because if this server is down even for minutes, all these millions of clients are going to be affected. Okay? And this concept is very important, and we'll talk about this centralized concept in just about every lesson in the network. This concept is very important. So there is always the centralized architecture and distributed architecture. The centralized architecture always has the disadvantage of a bottleneck, single point of failure. If the server is down, all the clients are dead. They cannot consume any service. Okay. Also, there is a limitation of what services the server can provide. Okay, the server, even though it's heavy duty and stuff, but it can host a limited amount of content. Okay, So if you imagine peer-to-peer, the power is actually in the human being. So you don't have any limitation on what content you get from anyone on the internet. And that's why BitTorrent is very famous. And many, many millions of people, they use it. Why? Because on one hand, you don't have to be dependent on a centralized server. Okay, so if one machine is down, go to another machine. Actually, the application gets or fetches the content from another machine and you don't even know about it. Okay, the other thing is that the content has no limitation. So you can download anything from anyone. Okay, of course, the issue on this side, though, is that there is less control. There's no control, actually. So we know that BitTorrent is used to exchange illegal content on the internet, and no one can actually pinpoint any legal issues in that regard. So there's many lawsuits on many of these peer-to-peer companies, but their idea is that we don't care. We don't host any content. People they use it. We just make the application available, and people are responsible for what they do. But we, as BitTorrent or eMule or eDonkey, we don't host any content. So that's why using this distributed architecture, you have less control, or in some cases, no control. Okay? So the same concept applies to, like, for example, Facebook. Facebook uses a similar concept because anyone can put a content on your page. Anyone that you are friends to, of course, puts a content on your webpage. So there is no limitation of what content comes into your webpage. There might be some dirty stuff in there. There might be some illegal content on your webpage or your Facebook page. Okay. So that uses a similar concept. So there is a human network. So that's an architecture which is slightly significantly different from the client server, where the server has limited content and full control. And if that server goes away, everybody is dead. Okay? So it's clear?
Another reason might be the cost of the server. Because servers use many high-end technology, so it's very costly.
Right, so of course this is part of the limitations of the server that there is a minimum requirement that has to be fulfilled in the server. So the server has to be heavy duty, has to be very high end because it responds to millions of clients. Whereas again for peer-to-peer, it's just a simple application that you set up on your machine, and depending on your network speed, you can exchange content as upload or download. We'll talk about that. But the server has to be very high-end, and usually it's owned by an organization. It's not owned by users like ourselves. A server is usually owned by organization or companies or something like that. So the high-end or the minimum requirements can be afforded easily by these organizations. Of course. In many cases, you try to connect on the client, and of course it doesn't happen very often nowadays because the hardware is very cheap, and you have like data centers now, and you have all this fancy hardware. But in the past, sometimes when you try to connect, it tells you that the server is busy because it can fulfill the requests for a limited number of clients, so it cannot serve unlimited number of clients. Okay, so it used to happen a lot for FTP servers. So you try to connect on an FTP to download a file, and it tells you that the FTP server is busy, or it has reached, it maxed out in terms of the number of clients that it can serve. So it asks you to connect some other time. So yes, it does affect the number of clients does affect. Okay, So quickly, we'll talk about LANs and WANs. So the components of the network, we have devices, and by devices here, we mean end devices or network devices, and we're going to talk about the difference between the two. And also on the network, you have media or content, which is what we talked about. So you have like files, you have videos, you have web pages. So this is the content that's hosted somewhere on the network, and using services, we can exchange this information. And we'll talk about the difference between what service means and what application means and what file or medium means, okay? But roughly, the network is a set of devices, okay? And we'll talk, we'll classify what devices are and content and services that allows us to exchange the content. And the most of the course, we're going to talk about these services. By services, we mean like high-level services or lower-level, like protocols and techniques and stuff. So most of the course, we're going to talk about services, okay? So when we talk about LANs and WANs, LAN is actually a local area network. So LAN stands for a local area network, which means that it's a set of devices that are located in a small geographical area. And therefore, we can cover all of them in one LAN or one local area network. And we usually in the LAN, we use switches and hubs and some network devices. Of course, we as users, we don't see these devices, but they are hosted in ITS. Or they are hosted in classrooms like this. So this is an access point. That's a network device. Okay? And that creates virtual LAN inside this classroom. So we all the devices in this room, they connect to this access point, in which case we form a local area network. It's a small network that covers a small geographical area, okay? So LAN is usually terminated by a router, okay? So once we get to a router, this is the termination of a LAN. So depending on how the network inside the university is organized, so maybe one router can connect to a LAN that covers one floor, okay? So that's a LAN. In this LAN, we only need to use switches and hubs. Once we get to a router, this is the termination of this LAN, and from one router to another, this is what we call a WAN or wide area network, okay? So in a LAN, we use switches and hubs. Or direct cables. Like for example, if I have a computer next to this and I want to communicate between the two computers, I can just use a cross cable as we will learn. I can use a direct cable. I don't need to have switch, I don't need to have router, I don't need to have anything. Or wireless, of course. But wireless has to go through that access point.
There is a Wi-Fi direct.
There is a Wi-Fi direct, yes. In which case, I don't need to have an access point in the middle. Okay. Once I get to a router, then this is a termination of a LAN. And usually, this router, it has to be close in the area so that we can connect from this LAN to another LAN. So once we have multiple LANs like this, we connect between these using what we call a WAN. Okay? So the devices are divided into two things. We have the end devices, and this is the interface to us as users. End devices is all our devices that we use on a daily basis. So our cell phones, our computers, our printers, our endpoints like telepresence endpoint, the IP phone from Cisco that we use in our offices. Security cameras, these are end devices. So the end device, and as we said, in the near future, it's going to be thin. So my shirt is going to be an end device. My pen is going to be an end device, and so on. Okay? That's the end device. And we have network devices. Network devices are the devices that facilitate the communication physically between the end devices. Network devices include switches, access points like this, routers, firewalls, and hubs, as well. So these are network devices. We, as users, we don't see these devices, but they do exist, because without their existence, we cannot communicate. Okay? So we have the clear end devices, and we have the hidden network devices, and only using the connection, the connectivity between the two, we can communicate.
Is the firewall a device or a software?
That's a very good question. A firewall can be either a software or a hardware. If it's here, we're talking about the hardware. Okay, if it's a standalone hardware dedicated for firewall, then it's a network device. Okay. But you're right, a firewall can be a simple application that I put on one machine, and then this machine acts as a firewall. Or actually, on all our machines, there is some kind of a firewall software, right? So, but here we're talking about heavy firewalls, which are dedicated hardware that is set up on ITS to act as a firewall for the entire campus. Okay.
We can have a router or a white point that has all of these together.
Yes, that's a condition. As we said, routers and switches are network devices that connects everyone, all the network or the end devices with the network devices on another LAN or another location. Okay. Any questions so far? I think we'll stop here.